All right, here we go, you guys. You're welcome to stand to your feet. We're going to worship the Lord. Clap with me. Here we go. Ready? Glorious day. This is a glorious day, isn't it? Hallelujah. I was buried beneath my shame.
Spirit of the Sovereign Lord, come and make your presence known, reveal the glory of the living God. Spirit of the Sovereign Lord, come and make your presence known, reveal the glory of the living God. your river flow. Let the truth of your kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of your glory, let the weight of your glory fall. Spirit of the sovereign Lord, come and make your presence known. Reveal the glory of the living God. Spirit of the sovereign Lord, come and make your presence known. Reveal the glory of the living God. Let the weight of your glory cover us. Let the life of your river flow. Let the truth of your kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of your glory, let the weight of your glory fall. Oh, we do not seek your hand. We only seek your face. To see you reveal through glory in this place. Let the weight of your glory cover us. Let the life of your river flow. Let the truth of your kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of your glory, let the weight of your glory fall. Let the weight of your glory cover us. Let the life of your river fall. Let the truth of your kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of your glory, oh, let the weight of your glory, let the weight of your glory.
Welcome to stand or sit or however you worship best.
My Lord, what shall I give? For sing it out loud. With all my strength, I still make him proud.
He paid it all for me, carried the cross for
across town, or a place where I don't know a soul. Just tell me where, and I'll hit the road. No time to spare, and no. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you.
Jesus, he's the one.
Jesus, the name above. Jesus, the only one who can ever say, worthy of every breath we can ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there Jesus' name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who can save. Worthy of every breath you could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like
Jesus. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's give him some praise. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We adore you. We give you all praise and all glory because you are worthy. We love you so much, Lord. Lord, we give ourselves and our lives as an offering to you today. We thank you, Father, that you have received our praises, Lord. And Lord, we want to walk. We want to walk in your spirit. We want to walk in fellowship with you 24/7, Lord. We want to walk in the center of your will, Lord. We want to be guided by you in every situation, Lord. We don't want to come just to church on Sunday, but we want to have church wherever we go, Lord. We want to have you, Lord Jesus, abiding in us, powerfully, Lord, ministering, Lord Jesus, to others as we speak to them, Father. We want to be your servants, Lord. We want to be those that are your ambassadors, Lord Jesus, that everybody that sees us will see your light in us, Father. We just give ourselves, we give our lives, we give everything that we have to you and to service to you, Lord Jesus. We bow the knee of our will to you, Lord Jesus, and we say, Lord Jesus, let your will be done, let your kingdom come in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Someone feel they have a word today. Thank you, Jesus.
Good morning. He says, I'm enough. I am everything you need. There is nothing you have to do to prove that you are good enough for me. I know, I see, I heard, I was there. There is no secret that you have that I do not see, and I still love you. I accept you. Come to me. Talk to me. There is no secrets. I know. I see it all. Don't be afraid. I love you with the purest love, with the love that runs deeper than the ocean. And there is nothing, absolutely nothing, that can take my love from you. And you are not less. I died for you. I went on the cross. I went through everything for you. That's how much I love you. And that's how much I want you to be mine. That's how much I value you. What I have is so much better than anything you could want for yourself. But you have to come. You have to open the heart, open the door. There is no secret. There is no shame. There is no filth. There is no lie. I covered all of that on the cross.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. All right, so we got a little special treat today. Of course, we have an Easter message. That's a little bit later. I just want to thank you for coming today, everybody who decided to share their Easter with us. We are so grateful that you're here. Thank you for coming. We love you. But Patrick, he leads the youth out in the back portable here, the teens, and he's going to introduce someone to us today that's a very special speaker. All right, Patrick?
Thanks. I have a special speaker today. Her name is Liz. Why don't you come up, Liz? And Liz is going to be leading communion today. I never had anybody in youth ever do that before, and the Lord told me she's the one. The Bible says to train young people up and to live out what Jesus has told us to do. And I know that she has a great word for us. Okay, Liz?
So I'm Elizabeth Phillips. I'm a junior in high school, and I've been in youth group for 2 years. My pastor, Tom, and Patrick actually baptized me and my brother 2 years ago, and ever since then, I've been spending a lot more time with God than I ever have. I was able to do communion in youth group, actually, before I am doing it today, and I was asked to do it today, and I'm very thankful and honored that I am able to do this today and share this experience with you. So, what is communion and why do we do it? Communion is about remembering what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross, but it is also to get our hearts right with him, to do it in a worthy manner, which it is in the Bible. And to do that, we must respect and acknowledge and be grateful for what he did. And we are commanded to do this, but we also should be thankful for it and acknowledge it, and that we need to forgive and forget, it's also about loving and forgiveness as Jesus has done for us. And so I ask, if there's anything holding you back, if there's anything you haven't really truly forgiven, I ask that you pray in repentance and forgiveness, that you make yourself vulnerable to God and to open your hearts and to get your hearts right with him. So I ask that you bow your heads and close your eyes and pray, and I'll give you a moment to do that. So not only do we get to celebrate communion today, but we also get to celebrate Easter. And communion is about representing his death, remembering what he did, and Easter is about his resurrection and how it proves that he's not only God, but it also gives us salvation, and it gives him his salvation, and it's also about fulfilling all the prophecies that were made in the Old Testament, that he defeated death, gave us our salvation. So I was rereading the Easter story and how he said that he would rise in 3 days. And even though people doubted it, they wanted to secure his tomb. And an angel came and rolled the stone and he walked out. And even his disciples that met him on a mountain in Galilee, like, doubted that he was there. And I thought that was really weird, because even though he was there with them, they doubted, but he responded with that he has the authority on heaven and on earth. And in youth group a few weeks ago, we talked about Palm Sunday, and I had no idea what that was. I didn't know about the Holy Week until that day, and we had to research it, and we had to explain what it was. And so I learned that it was when Jesus Christ came to Jerusalem on a donkey that symbolized his humbleness and his peacefulness. And not only that, but he was born in a manger, and that symbolizes his humbleness. So when I was rereading the story, I came across a verse, Luke 23:34. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." And when I read that verse, I cried, because even though on Palm Sunday, when these people laid palm leaves on the ground to honor him, the next week they wanted to kill him, and he was betrayed as well. And even though he was in this situation, despite that, he forgave and loved each and every one of us. And he was on the cross, and he thought of each and every one of us. When he was on that cross, he thought, "I died for each and every one of you because I love you so very much." Amen. And I think that's just amazing. I think it's the most amazing thing to think about. Because you hear people say that I die for you, but Jesus Christ actually did that. He actually did that. And it was prophesied, and he knew what he had to do. He didn't have to do it, but he did it because he loved us so much that Jesus Christ sent his only begotten son and died on that cross, and he had risen from the grave 3 days later. So the Lord's Supper, which was also an example to us on what we should do in communion, was the last meal that he had with his disciples. And the disciples that he trained for 3 years didn't understand what he was trying to say when he told them that this was going to be his last meal before he has to suffer. And then a week later, he died on the cross. They had no idea what he was talking about, and they also were worried about the fact that there was going to be a betrayal, but despite that, Jesus still loved each and every one of them. It shows his unconditional love, his mercy, his forgiveness, his long-suffering, his goodness. And as this served as an example, it also introduced the body and the blood, which is represented by the bread and the cup. So the bread represents the body, and it represents how he broke his body for us, that he was mocked, he was beaten, he was whipped, yet despite that, he endured it all, and he thought of us. He thought of us as he was on that cross, as he was enduring all of this pain. And that the cup represents the blood, which represents the second covenant that he made for us, that he shed his blood for us, that he was the perfect lamb, and thus being the ultimate sacrifice, so that we don't have to sacrifice anymore. Because before, we had a priest. We had to go to a priest, and they had to pray for us. But since Jesus died, he gave us this personal, supernatural relationship with God, something they didn't have before. And we also had to sacrifice animals every year to cover that year of our sins. But when Jesus Christ died, he forgave each and every sin that we've ever committed. So I ask that you take up your cup and you take the wafer. I ask you to hold it up. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for Lord God, you broke your body for us. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you suffered on that cross because you love us so very much, that you sacrificed everything you had. Thank you, Lord Heavenly Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for this moment. And I ask that you take this in remembrance of him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Now I ask that you open the cup, the juice. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this is your blood that you shed for us. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you gave us a second covenant to have this personal, supernatural relationship with you, Heavenly Father, that we can feel your love. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for forgiving us for all of our sins, that you love us, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. And I ask this, that you take this in remembrance of him. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for sharing this experience with me.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, these folks have been patiently waiting up here. Let's give our worship team a big hand. We're going to let them go. We'll let them go and sit down and have a couple of announcements. I want to remind you tonight at 6:30 p.m. is our healing service. So if you need healing or know someone that needs healing, 6:30 p.m., we will be here to pray for you. We've taken away the need to have reservations, so you just show up, and we're going to be praying for you tonight. We've seen God work so many miracles, and we know he has a miracle for you too. Also, want to remind you, this coming Wednesday, we're having our brand new Wednesday night series is starting at 7:30 p.m. It's called The Case for Christ, and Gail and I will both be facilitating that. And so our last series was done by my wife, Paula, and it was just dynamite. It was awesome. So Gail and I have got something to really live up to here, you know. But she did such a fantastic job. But join us this Wednesday at 7:30 p.m., and I know you won't be sorry. The Case for Christ was written by, originally, it was a book written by a man named Lee Strobel. And he was an investigative reporter, and he was also a lawyer. And he was going to basically write a paper on how he did not believe in God, and God could not be real, and Jesus could not be the Savior. But he ended up, through all of his research and all of his discovery, he ended up becoming a believer. And so the case for Christ will show you not only why you should be believing what we believe, but also show you how to communicate it to others who may not know Jesus. So come and join us this Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. All right. So today is Easter. Now, a lot of folks don't like to call it Easter if they go to church, so we could call it Resurrection Sunday. Some people call it, you know, Passover, but Resurrection Sunday, this commemorates the day that Jesus Christ rose from the grave after he was crucified. So the title of the message this morning is In Due Time. Now, there was a time, believe it or not, and that's a word I use loosely here, there was a time before time began. That sounds a bit like a riddle, doesn't it? It was a time that was outside of time as we know it right now. It was a time in eternity past when God had not yet begun to create the things in the physical realm that we see here today. It was a time before Genesis chapter 1, where it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It was before that. It was before that. And sometimes it's difficult for us as human beings to grasp these concepts like eternity, like infinity. It seems like how can something go on forever? Like omnipresence, how can God be everywhere all at one time? Like omniscience, how can God know everything there is to know? But those are terms that correctly describe God's nature. So all of these concepts lack limitations, and our lives are full of limitations. So it's a little hard for us sometimes to stretch our imaginations to match the truth of who God is. It's hard to grasp, but as hard as it is to grasp, these are accurate descriptions of God. He is infinite. He was before time. He is eternal. He has always been. He will always be. Now, believe it or not, if you want to talk about eternity in the case of God, you're talking about eternity past as well as eternity future. But if you want to talk about eternity in the matter of a Christian, we are eternal beings. We had a starting point, but we shall live forever because of Christ. So from this point on, if you have Christ in your heart, you will never die. Now you say, I might die physically. Yes, but your eyes in the spirit will never close. You will be with Christ and you will live forever and ever and ever. Now that's hard to imagine. It's hard to imagine what we'll be thinking about everything that's going on right here today a million years from now. You know, probably won't be thinking about, will we? We'll just be enjoying the presence of God. So God, who created all things, thinks on a level that we can't even imagine. And he works on a level that would completely blow our minds, and it will blow your mind if you delve into it a little bit. But still, that's who he really is. That's who he really is. Our God is beyond amazing. Our God is beyond awesome. Here's what it says about himself, by himself, in Isaiah 55, 8, says this, 8 and 9. It says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now, if you were on a boat in the North Atlantic, and you saw an iceberg like the one that the Titanic struck, and you could take a photo saying, I actually saw an iceberg, and you went back home and told your friends, I actually saw an iceberg. The fact of the matter would be, at best, you saw 10% of an iceberg. You didn't see the whole thing, because there's 90% of that thing that you cannot see. It's beneath the surface. You say, I saw the tip of an iceberg. That would be true, but you didn't see a whole iceberg. You really didn't. So our understanding of God's nature is kind of like that. We see the tip of the iceberg. We know a little bit about God. And someday we're going to know him even as we are known. But at this point, we know in part, the Bible says. We know in part. Our understanding of God's nature is sort of limited at this point. Now, sometimes these thoughts make our God seem a little bit alien to us. He's so awesome. He's so mighty. He's so powerful. He seems like he's so set apart from us. He's so different from us. He's so unrelatable to us at times. But that isn't the way he has planned for things to stay. He wants you to know him. He wants you to know him intimately. Actually, God wants us to know him just as we're known. Through time, God has revealed more and more of himself to man by his interaction with us throughout history, and he's made the fullest revelation that can be known about himself to us in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said to Philip, he says, "When you have seen me, Philip, you have seen the Father." Hebrews 1:1-3 says this about Jesus Christ. On many past occasions and in many different ways, God spoke to our fathers through the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory, listen to this, and the exact representation of his nature, upholding all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. The Son is the exact representation of the Father. The more you get to know the Son, the more you know the Father. The greatest revelation of God's person that has ever been given to us has been found in Jesus Christ. We now have a much bigger picture than all those Old Testament prophets had. They hadn't seen Jesus yet. We've seen Jesus. We have seen the revelation of the Father more than they prophesied about, more than they ever knew. Even Moses meeting God on the mountain, he didn't know him like we can know him today. The more we know Jesus, the more we know the Father. And as I said before, Jesus said to Philip, John 14:9, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and yet you don't know who I am? Anyone who's seen me has seen the Father, so why are you asking me to show him to you?" Today we have the opportunity to know God intimately and personally, more than any person ever had the opportunity before the cross. You know, you could have been Isaiah, you could have been Hosea, you could have been all those Old Testament prophets. You could have said, "I'm pressing in, I'm trying to pray and really get a connection with God and really get to know God more personally and really get to get a glimpse of the infinite." They tried. But it cannot match what you and I can experience, because God, who is infinite, lives inside of us. He has put his Spirit within us. We don't sometimes visit his Spirit through prayer, but his Spirit lives and abides in us eternally. We know more than they knew in the Old Testament, but you know what? It's not over yet. There's a whole lot more to know. 1 Corinthians 13:12 says this, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now we know in part, then I shall fully be known, even as I am fully known." Can you imagine? Can you even imagine? I know you can't. I'm just saying that. This is a rhetorical question. Can you imagine fully knowing God in all of his awesomeness? Can you imagine grasping that? Well, your little brain would blow up. Trust me. Okay? We cannot know him with these minds. But you know, in the spirit, there's a spirit mind, and you will be able to handle that. And someday we will be walking with him, fully knowing him as he knows us. And that's his plan for us. Okay? 1 John 3:2, "Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what it will be like when Christ appears. But we do know this, we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is." You know, when we see Christ appearing in the clouds, coming for his people during the resurrection of the dead, do you know you'll be changed? In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, you will be changed into an immortal being. You will put on a physical form that is immortal, and you will see him as he is. And because you see him as he is, you will become like him. You see, Moses got a little glimpse of God, and it affected him. It was like radiation. It affected him. His face shone with glory. It shined. But that wore off. But we're going to get a full facial, experience of seeing Jesus eye to eye. And when we do, it's going to transform every part of our being. Every cell in your body will convert into something that is supernatural. And you will live forever. So with the understanding that God knows all things, that he has all power, that he stands outside of the constricts of time, that it should be apparent that nothing has ever caught him off guard. You realize that? God is never surprised. Like, "Oh my gosh, what just happened?" God is never surprised. He has always had one plan from the beginning. You see, some people feel like God had a nice plan, and the plan was to have Adam and Eve in the garden, and everything would go well, and they would walk correctly and not fall into sin, and life would just perpetuate, and they'd have children, and it'd all be just wonderful and rosy. But God knew before he created man that man would fall. He didn't have a plan B. He's always had only a plan A. He knew exactly what was going to happen. Everything, believe it or not, in your life right now, I know this is going to seem impossible. If you're walking in the will of God, everything in your life is going exactly according to plan. You go, well, it can't be. It's chaos. God has a plan. Everything is happening exactly as scheduled. Do you realize that? God is on his throne and nothing could thwart his plan. Nothing. Here's one of the scriptures that indicate God's plan being perfectly on schedule. Romans 5, 6. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Due time. You mean God had a due time? He had an exact due time. He had a due second. He had a due millisecond. He said at exactly this time, Christ will die according to the plan. It's not a plan B. Here's one of the scriptures that indicates God's plan is being perfectly on schedule. Says this, Galatians 4, 4 through 6. But when the set time had fully come. Did you hear that? When the set time, who set the time? God set the time. When the set time had fully come, God sent his son born of a woman. He chose the woman. He chose the time. Under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship, because you are his sons. God sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, a spirit who cries out, Abba, Father. At the exact time, at the set time, the time that God had proposed from the very beginning, he had planned the whole time. At that time, Christ appeared. He was born of a woman. At that time, he lived a life on earth for around 30 years before he began his ministry. And then for 3 years, that time of ministry, he trained his 12 apostles. And after about 3.5 years, he died on a cross. And every single part of that was planned before man was created. Before man was made, that was all planned, okay? When the time had fully come, it says in that verse we just read, it had fully come. You mean, can we just, Lord, push this forward a little bit and let it start early? Can we have the rapture today? No, no, there's a fullness of time. There's an exact time, and God has a plan for the timing. You see, the reason God isn't going to come right now is because there's still some that haven't gotten in the ark. There's still some that haven't gotten in the kingdom. You see, some of us, if you're miserable with life, you want Jesus to come right now. But you know what? If you understand that you already have your ticket punched, you're already going to heaven, you realize that this life is just a short little time here. It says our life is but a vapor, appears for a moment, then vanishes away. If you realize that you're staying here a little bit longer may mean someone else getting into heaven, then you realize the importance of your life. Right? So, when the time had fully come, not before, not after, not as a reaction to something that went wrong, but exactly as it was planned from the beginning, before the beginning. Ephesians 1, 3 through 12. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. You know, he didn't have to do that, but he's good. For he chose us, he didn't have to choose us, but he did. Before the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless in his presence. Do you realize that? Before the foundation of the world, before he created Adam, he already had you in mind, and you were on the schedule to meet with him in eternity. It says, before the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless in his presence, in love he predestined us. Did you hear that? It's because he loved you that he predestined you to become a son and daughter of God. He chose you before you existed. Before anybody knew about you, before there was a history to be written, he knew all about you. He knew all of your days. Predestined for us for adoption as his sons through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will. Do you realize that he didn't hold his nose and say, I guess I got it because I'm a lover. I guess I got to accept you rotten people. No, he actually said, I do this for my good pleasure because actually I enjoy you. Right? To the praise of his glory and grace, which he has freely given us in the Beloved One. In him we have redemption through his blood, that's in Jesus, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. Boy, that's, you have to be crazy to lavish that kind of love on people that are so unworthy. But it says this, it says he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. He knew exactly what he was doing. He knew exactly what he was doing. But you didn't know what you were getting, Lord, when you asked me to, you know, come into the family. Oh, he knew. He knew exactly. He knew that you'd be messing up. He knew when you'd walk with him and when you'd walk away and when you'd come back. He knew all those things. But he chose you anyway. He died for you anyway. It says, with all wisdom and understanding, he's talking about the fact that in advance of this thing, he had a perfect plan from the start. This is not catching him off guard. And he made us, he has made known to us the mystery of his will. What is that? That he chose you before the foundation of the world, that you would be his sons and daughters, that you would be his family, because that brings him pleasure, because he loves you, right? He's always had this desire to do it. It's according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to bring all things in heaven and earth together. Do you hear that? A plan for the fullness of time. There's a schedule here, and he's right on schedule. To bring all things on earth together in Christ, in him we are also chosen as God's own. We already were his own from the beginning. From the beginning. You were always part of his plan from the beginning. Having predestined according to the plan of him, he has a plan, who works out everything according to the counsel of his will. He actually did it because he wants it. He actually wants you. He actually knew that Adam would blow it. He actually knew that you would blow it. He actually knew the price he would have to pay. He actually knew that his son would have to come and suffer and die on a cross and die for the sins of mankind and carry that weight. He knew all that, and he said, but you're worth it, but I'm willing to do it. Are you sure you know what you're paying up front? He knew what he was paying up front. It's part of the plan. It's part of the plan. The thought that God was caught off guard when Adam sinned and therefore had to come up with a plan B is simply not true. God has never had a plan B, okay? God has never been caught off guard. God has always had only one plan, and the plan centers around the work and the person of Jesus Christ, his son. Jesus was sent by the Father to die on a cross to pay the penalty for your sins and my sins, and he already knew he was going to have to do that even before he set foot on earth. To be resurrected on the third day, to bring into the family of God every person that would look to him for salvation, was part of the plan. Today is Easter, or Resurrection Day, and this was the day that brought the revelation of what God had been planning ever since the beginning. See, this is a day where people woke up. Because, you know, the disciples hadn't quite gotten it yet. Because before Jesus rose from the dead, they gave up. They said, oh, we thought he would be the one. Oh, we thought he was going to lead us into great victory. Oh, we thought he was the Savior. But look, now he's dead. But when he rose from the dead, they recognized he has the power of life and death. They realized this was all part of the plan. It's all part of the plan. Jesus dying on the cross looked like the last chapter to them at one point. You know that? They thought it was over, but 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead and declared a brand new chapter, which God has written before the world began. It was all part of the plan. I can assume that most of you know what Easter is all about, or you probably wouldn't have come today. Now, to some, Easter is about the once-a-year gift given to God where you go to church. Okay? Yeah. To some people, Easter is about bunny rabbits that lay eggs. Hollow chocolate bunnies. I always felt that was a ripoff as a kid. You had this giant bunny in a box, and you thought, it's chocolate. It's empty. It was an empty bunny. It was just a shell. Yeah, like an empty tomb. So some people think it's about those nasty little fluorescent-colored marshmallow chicks. Oh, those nasty, nasty things. Those shouldn't even be illegal. Some people think it's about Easter lilies and ham dinners. Okay? Well, actually, that's pretty much what most people in the world think. We, however, who are more solemn and religious-minded, remind ourselves that on this day 2,000 years ago, an innocent man named Jesus was nailed to a cross by a cruel world, right? A Jesus that was rather emaciated and helpless, and he was very misunderstood. He was an outcast. He seemed like the consummate underdog who was powerless, and he was mocked and persecuted and ultimately martyred. Now, I want you to erase all that. Don't think that way. None of that kind of thinking ever comes close to revealing the truth behind God's master plan. God, who has always existed, who created all things, who knows all things, who holds the power to have everything that holds together by his power, who is the purest, most holy being in the whole universe and any other universe, and who stands outside of time, always had a plan. Plan A. The plan to some might seem complicated, but he's God, so he can do complicated stuff. He can multitask, right? But then again, we're attempting to understand his plan through our limited minds, but he's infinitely more intelligent than you or I. Do you know that? The same God who created the universe, who brought into existence all physical matter by the power of his words, who created all things, beings spiritual and beings in the physical world, who created the complex systems which control the function of the orbits of the planets and the universe, right down to the microscopic function of the DNA in our bodies. He designed all that. Yeah? He only had one plan. He didn't have a plan B. He didn't have a backup plan. It's one plan. He didn't come up with a plan one day when he was daydreaming. You know, it's kind of boring being all alone. What am I going to do next? I don't know. I know. I'll create some people. That'll be fun. I can play with them. They'll be like pets. No. He never came up with an idea that was new to him. He's always known everything. Always. You say, but that's impossible. Yeah, it's impossible for you. It's not impossible for him. He always knew about you. He always knew about the plan. He always knew before the day of creation everything that would happen from beginning to end. Everything. He's known it all. He can see you right now a million years from now with him. He sees it like it was right now, because he stands outside of time. It didn't just dawn on him all of a sudden like, oh, I've got a great idea. It never happened that way. But the all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-existent God over all things always knew the plan, and he had set an appointed time when the plan would be put into motion. Now, you know, you wonder that about your life, see? If you walk with him, he has a plan, okay? Now, you can walk contrary to him, and you won't fulfill the plan he has for you. But if you walk with him, he has a plan for you. And the plan has scheduled timing. And it'll all happen exactly as it's supposed to happen. You go, oh, I've been waiting so long. You know, I said that when I was 28 years old. I said, I've been waiting so long for a wife, Lord. Come on, let's get on with this thing. I've been waiting since I was 18 years old. I've been praying and praying and praying. Well, when I was 28, boom, it happened. I go, oh, in the fullness of time. Right? He has a fullness of time. He knows when you're ready. He knows when the next step is supposed to happen. Okay? He has a plan. Go with his plan. Anyway, as I said, he stands outside of time, but for the sake of his creation and his great plan, he created time, and then the clock began. And his very first words recorded in the beginning in Genesis chapter 1 was, in the beginning. He's like, start the clock. Now we have a beginning. He didn't have a beginning, but we have a beginning. Creation had a beginning. Every angel had a beginning. The clock had started, and now the plan of all ages was about to unfold before the eyes of every angelic being, every demonic being, and every man himself would see God's great plan unfolding. And this is what it was all about. This was the beginning of the revelation of God's one and only plan. All life comes from God, and God cannot die. God is not just a figure of history past. He is ever present. He has always been. He will always be. He is alive right now. Revelations 1:8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. That's who he is. The eternal God can be described in many words, such as awesome, such as powerful, such as all-knowing, all-wise, and so on. But of himself, he chose to describe himself summed up in one word. He declares the essence of his nature in one word. He could have chosen a million words. He chose one word, and the word is love. He says, that's who I am. 1 John 4:16, and so we know and rely on the love God has for us, for God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. God is love, and God sent proof of his love in his son, Jesus Christ. He didn't send flowers on Easter. He didn't send chocolates. He didn't send us a gift card, but he sent us the best he had, his son. 1 John 4:9 and 10, this is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. He loved you even before you were created. He loves you right now. You go, well, now that I've actually been born and can mess up a lot, now he probably doesn't like me so much. He loves you right now. He's always loved you. He already knew what he was buying into, right? A lot of people maybe get married without courting long enough, and they find out more stuff after they get married. You know, like, oh, I had no idea you were like that. But you know what? God came into this with his eyes both open. He knew exactly who you were, and he chose you anyway. Why? Because he loves you. But how can he love me? You know? Well, this word love is this Greek word, agape, which is a word that describes the only kind of love that God has. It's a special kind of love. It's beyond natural love. It's the most powerful thing in the universe or any other realm. It's the kind of love that is absolutely pure and without equal. It's the kind of love that is completely selfless, completely unconditional, completely unstoppable, unshakable, cannot be defeated, cannot be subdued by any other force. It is the greatest power that there is. So some people ask a pretty dumb question sometimes. But can God still love me after I've done this? God is love, okay? If your sin is greater than his love, then you're greater than God. He can't change who he is because you sin. He's going to be love no matter what. He's going to love you no matter what. You say, but I'm unlovable. He doesn't care. He still loves you. You may be unlovable to everybody else on earth, but to him, he loves you, right? God is love. He cannot hate you because he cannot hate people because he created them in his image and his likeness, and he created them out of his love. He can't hate you. It's not in his character to hate you. He can do no other thing. He can do no other thing but to love you. Even if you defy him, he loves you. He loves you if you hate him. He can't help himself. That's just who he is. He loved us before we ever loved him. 1 John 4:19, we love because he first loved us. You know? God, who is love and who does everything based on the motivation of love, had an eternal desire, a desire that makes a lot of sense. You see, real love is selfless, and it's got to be given. It's got to be shared. God was alone at one point, but that love, he wanted to share that love. That means that love is something that must be given to another, not something that you keep for yourself. Okay? God did not need anything, but that doesn't change the fact that he desired something. He desired fellowship with you and with me. He created us for his good pleasure, it says, out of his love, right? Revelation 4:11, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they were created. That includes you. But you don't know, Lord, I've messed up. He knew that. He already knew that. You see, you were not created out of God's lack or out of God's need, but actually for God's pleasure. Now back to the eternal plan. God, who is love, desired to have someone to bestow that love upon and to eternally share that love with. And that's where you come in and where I come in. The scripture makes it plain that man was made different than all the other creatures. He was the only one, even including the angels, he's the only one created in God's image and likeness. Of man alone, says this, Genesis 1:26. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth on the earth. He said, let us make man in our image. The creation of man was the reason for the creation of everything else. Man is the jewel of God's creation. He is the crowning achievement above all else that God has created, and he put all else under him. Man was created in God's image, and man was created in God's likeness so that man alone could experience intimate fellowship with him like no other creation. God created man to be an object of and a recipient of all of his love. That's his gift to you. He created us to be his eternal companions. And you know what? You might go, I don't know, I might get tired of God. You won't get tired of God. You're designed in such a way that all of your pleasure and all of your joy will be fulfilled in being with him. God did not make man as a robot that was forced to love him, but God gave man the most dangerous power in the universe, which is the power of choice. That's a dangerous thing because there's a whole lot of people who won't choose Jesus. But God never had a plan B. Never had a plan B. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So, he never had a contingent plan, just in case man messed everything up, because man already does mess everything up, doesn't he? God always knew what would happen before it happened, and he knew man would choose wrong. He knew man would fall in the garden. He knew that he would have to save us from our sins. He knew the price he would have to pay for us up front. But out of love, he was willing to do it anyway, because he said, but it's worth it. Even if that price was the blood of his own son. 1 Peter 1:18 through 21. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors. But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen, listen to this, before the creation of the world. And so were you. But was revealed in these last times, in due time, for your sake. Through him you believe in God who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. When man sinned, God already had prepared a remedy. The Bible tells us that sin is punishable by death. The Bible also tells us that God is both just and merciful. Now, this is a difficult balance, justice and mercy, because justice says you have to pay the price for your sin, but mercy says, but I'd like to let you off. Okay? So in God's justice, someone had to pay the penalty for sin. And in God's mercy, God provided a substitute to pay the penalty. It wasn't you and it wasn't me. It was Jesus Christ. He's the sacrificial Lamb of God. God could have said, he's my son. I won't make him do it. We'll just write it off. He says, no, in my justice, someone has to pay the penalty. All right, now let's move forward and talk about the day we call Easter. Easter is not the day that Jesus died on the cross. Obviously, we know that. That was on the Friday before Easter. Easter is not the day that Jesus was buried in a stone tomb. No, that was three days before. So you might recall just before Jesus died on the cross, he declared something very important. He said these words. Jesus said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. And the word it is finished is the word tetelestai, which is a Greek word, which actually means it is paid in full. What was paid in full? The price for all of your sins. The debt was paid in full. The separation that sin had caused between God and man had been done away with. And now, once again, the door had been opened for man to fellowship freely and intimately with God himself through faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. He finished the work. So what about Easter? His death was vitally important, but what was of equal importance was his resurrection. Everybody can die. But to resurrect yourself, that's impressive. On the third day after the death of Jesus, he rose from the dead, and he is alive today. And he's alive forevermore. When I was a little boy, I wasn't brought up in church, but I did go to church on Easter a couple of times, because that's what people did in those days. They just went to church on Easter. And I felt bad about this Jesus who I saw hanging on a cross. I said, that's too bad. People beat him up and hurt him, and now he's dead. That's a horrible story. I didn't know he was alive. I didn't know he was alive. When I was 17 years old, I met Jesus, and I found out he was alive. And he came, and he moved in, and he lives within me. And there's not a day that he's apart from me, but he's in me. It says that those that are joined to the Lord are one spirit with him. His spirit is in me. I'm a tabernacle. You are a tabernacle of God. Wherever you go, you carry God's presence. He lives within you. Because why? Well, it says he's holy. It says that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And you couldn't be the temple of the Holy Spirit unless God had made you holy. And he made you holy because you received salvation through his son who paid the penalty for your sins. So Luke 24, 1 through 7. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but they entered. They did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men clothed in gleaming clothing, like lightning, stood beside them. And in their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified on the third day, be raised again. Now, I have preached sermons in the past, Easter sermons, where I have gone into minute detail to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt to any open mind that Jesus is the only man in all of history to fulfill all of the prophecy of the Messiah to come. He's the only one. I put forth strong arguments and airtight cases, I believe, about the resurrection of Christ being the most evidential fact of history over everything else. There is more evidence that Jesus rose from the grave than there is that Abraham Lincoln lived. Do you realize that? There really is. Jesus died, Jesus rose, Jesus ascended into heaven, and Jesus sits on the right hand of majesty right now. All of that is true, but what I want to tell you today is this. Jesus is not just alive, but Jesus is in me and every person who believes in his finished work, who's received salvation through him, who has redemption through his blood. But guess what? He's not finished yet. He's not finished yet. As long as there still is one person who has never had the opportunity to receive salvation that God provided for all men at the cross, then God is still working amongst us. He's working upon the hardened hearts of men. He's working to draw people to himself. And if you will be a person who lifts Jesus up, he says, I'll draw all men unto me. He is working still to reveal his love and his eternal plan to those people who don't even know him. I thank God for another Easter, because each Easter, we can see more people brought into the kingdom. More people brought into the kingdom. And that's what it's all about. He didn't create man to suffer and die and live an eternity in hell. He created man for his good pleasure to be with him eternally. Right? What I want to tell you about Jesus is he's here right now. His wonders are here right now. There are some churches where it's like it's the empty tomb. Jesus is not here, but someday he's coming back. I want you to know this, as Jesus came into this empty tomb, and now I live. I was empty. I didn't have him in me, but he walked into this empty tomb, to this dead carcass, and he filled me with his presence, and he filled each and every one of you. And sometimes we forget that because we get so earthly minded, right? Now, for the past few years, I and many of you have stepped across an invisible spiritual threshold that has separated us from the stories about God's power to actually seeing God's power. We have seen and witnessed God's power so much in this church. It's amazing. All the miracles that we have seen. Not only does Jesus want to talk with you on a daily basis, but Jesus wants to work miracles in your life today. And he wants to be you to be an ambassador for him to the lost people of this world. Now, I've experienced, and many of us have experienced, some pretty mind-boggling things in the last few years. And some you've experienced apart from me. And I have seen myself uncountable miracles, instantaneous healings taking place before my eyes. I've seen chronic backs, shoulders, knees, joints instantly healed. I've seen abscessed and painful teeth instantly healed. I've seen cancers disappear. I've seen dead organs come back to life. I've seen tumors disappear. I've seen all these things, but you know what? We can all see all these things because Christ is alive and he's working. He's working. He's working, but he wants to work through each one of us. You might think that's crazy and hard to believe. I'm going to tell you one that's really crazy. Years ago, I have witnesses here, okay, so I'm not lying. So years ago, before I was married, I was with my wife and her family. We were in a church, and a man was preaching, and he wasn't praying. He was just preaching. And he said the funniest thing, which back in those days, you'd never heard about this. Now you hear about this. And he said, you know, the funny thing is, when I'm talking, a lot of times people get fillings in their teeth. And I thought, well, that's the weirdest thing anybody should say. What a weird thing to say. Why would God put fillings in people's teeth? Why would he just give them a brand new tooth? You know, I had all my thoughts, my preconceived thoughts. But while we were sitting there, my mother-in-law, my sister-in-law, my father-in-law got fillings in their teeth. So what I'm telling you is metal appeared out of nowhere and got into their mouth. Now, if you told me that story, I'd say, you made that up. I can't deny it. I was there. So what I'm telling you is God is a miracle worker. God is alive. God is present today. And God is doing magnificent things. We just have to join ourselves to what he is doing. Okay? So there's a lot of crazy things he can do. Now, why all these strange and wonderful things he's working amongst us? Because God is giving the evidence that he's alive. He wants you to know he's alive. He wants you to see him moving. Okay? Jesus is saying to you and me, I am alive forever, and if you will believe in me, you will live forever too. Easter is the reminder that a whole new life began for the people of this world the day Jesus walked out of that tomb. And you and I can share in that life with him beginning right now. We don't have to wait because the appointed time already came. It already came. So it's available to everybody today. He did it all because he loved us. He is speaking to your inner man because he loves you. If you have not asked Jesus to save you, then you are spiritually dead. You're entombed in a mortal body. You're destined for a godless eternity. But that's not his plan for you. His plan for you is salvation. His plan for you is redemption. His plan for you is eternal life. Today, Jesus is rolling back the stone that has blocked a lot of entrances to people's hearts. He's giving you the truth of his word because he wants to enter in and make you a brand new person. What's Easter all about? Oh, it's about the unfolding of the great plan, the plan A, the plan to save all mankind, to whosoever would believe on the Son, Jesus Christ, that you can have your empty tomb filled with the Spirit of God and you can become an eternal being that could spend eternity in God's presence. That's his plan for you. Why? Because he loves you. Why would he love me so much? Just because that's who he is. That's who he is. So I want to say this today as we close. If there's anybody here today who has never, and I don't mean you were brought up in a church. I don't mean you went to a Sunday school. I mean you made a specific commitment to Jesus Christ. If you've never asked him to come into your heart and save you, if you've never said, I'll repent for my sins, save me. If you've never done that, this is the day to do that. If you've never done that, if you want to make sure that you have a place in heaven, I want to ask you to raise your hand. We'll pray with you. Why be afraid of going to heaven? Don't be afraid. If there's anybody here who has not asked him to come in to their heart, thank you, Jesus. All right. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your salvation through your Son. We thank you that you had a plan and we were part of your plan. We thank you that we're not here by mistake, Lord. Lord, we weren't aborted because you wanted us here because you had a plan for our lives, Lord. And we thank you that we're here to do your will, Lord. We want to surrender our lives to your will, Lord. We want you to have your way in our lives, Lord. And we want to glorify you. And we want to, Lord, be lights that shine so bright that we draw many to you because that's what it's all about, Lord, is people meeting you and receiving you. So, Father, thank you for your great love for us. Thank you that we were planned, all of us. Thank you that your plan has unfolded to us and we've received you as our Savior. And now, Lord, as we walk forward in this life, we ask you to be glorified. We ask you, Lord, to lead us in every step of the way that we can fulfill the plan you have for us from this point on. We surrender our lives to you, Lord. And we thank you that you are alive and in us right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for spending your Easter with us.